Hello and welcome to Living Word, growing a family that experiences every promise of God. You're listening to another life-changing word from Pastor Jason Anderson. For more information, visit our website at livingwordonline.com.
Today I want to talk to you about the winds of change. Been talking about being led by the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God is often metaphorically equated to wind. In the Hebrew, the word ruach is wind and spirit. It's used interchangeably. And also in the Greek, it's pneuma, which is wind and spirit, used interchangeably. And Romans chapter 8 says that you, however, are controlled by the Spirit of God. It says just before that that the spirit nature of God has desires. Jesus said it this way. He said, the wind goes where it wants. But he uses the word pneuma or spirit. The spirit goes where it wants. It makes sense. God has a will. And then he says this. So also are those who are born of the Spirit. Say, I am born of the Spirit. So there's a desire that God places in you to get you to go where he wants you to go. And sometimes we say, God, just tell me what to do and I'll do it. Right? God, just tell me. Say where you want me to go, and I'll go. But God knows you better than that. He knows mankind better than that. He tell people what to do all the time they don't do. Adam and Eve don't eat the fruit. What do? It doesn't work. God telling you what to do doesn't get you to always do what he wants you to do. Why? Because we say, I don't want to. Jonah, I would like you to go to Nineveh and preach. I don't want to. And so what God has done now is he leads us by coming into us with his spirit and changing our desires. He gets you to do what you want to do because it's what he wants you to do. We say, God, what do you want me to do for you? And he says, I want you to do what you want to do for me. That's how one of the ways that he leads us. So today I want to talk about this wind and how it blows into your life a new desire. And it's a desire that he's given you. And sometimes that desire is changing you. The winds of change. People resist change. We don't want to change. But no matter what you do, summer is coming. The seasons are going to change. Somebody say amen. Amen. You can complain about it. You can fight it. It's still coming. It's going to get hot in Arizona. You can't stop it. My son, Christian, when he was a little baby, we gave him what's called the binky. How many know what a binky is? A binky is the little tool that you put inside of a kid's mouth when you don't want him to make noise anymore. He just put that in his mouth, right? He's like, ah! And so you give him the binky, right? And it kind of... But how many know that there comes an age when the binky is no longer acceptable? See, it was fine up till now, but in our household, we have a rule. Once you're as tall as me, you can't have a binky anymore. That was our rule. We drew the line. Seventh grade, about that time, no more binky. The girls would make fun of you. No. But when they're little, there's coming an age where you look at the kid and you're like, you're too old to have a binky now. And so you go and take the binky, and it was fine that they had the binky up till then. It was fine. You didn't care. But now you're like, I got to remove the binky because we're going to another level, and you can't take the binky to the next level. I got to take it out of your mouth. And the war began. I'm not trying to be mean. I'm trying to get you ready for the next stage of your life. Give me the binky. And here comes the crying. And here comes the mad. And I want my binky and the kicking and screaming. You know that God sometimes allows us to be in something for a while, but then he says, I need to take you to a new level. So I've got to come into your life, change a desire. And there may become resistance to change. He said, and you say, well, I always had this before. I'm not angry, I'm just a man. I'm not jealous, I'm just in love. You say, I don't want the pressure of a promotion. I don't want to be that. I know the pastor says that God's going to raise us up, but I don't want to be the boss. It's all stressful. I just want to do my thing. I don't want to be raised up. I don't like talking in front of people. I'll never be that kind of person. And we create these scenarios in our life where we say, I don't want this change. When I first got married, I thought that I knew how to dress myself before I got married. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? I thought I knew. She never complained about how I dressed. But then as soon as the ring go on, I come out the closet, she says, you can't wear that. What are you talking about? I've been dressing like this, and I hate being told what to do, right? You know, we resist change. We do. We inherently resist change. And so some things, when God comes into your life, fell off you easy. You used to have worry, but Jesus came in your life. The Spirit of God came inside you. He blew that wind inside you, and worry just fell off. I don't worry no more. You used to get offended and have unforgiveness, but it just fell off. You're like, I don't deal with that no more. But my mom says this. She says, when I got born again, smoking just fell off me. Right? Just fell off. And my dad says, when I got born again, smoking didn't fall off me. I still want to smoke. Don't look at me all religious like that. Don't do that. There's nothing wrong with smoke. Smoke is not going to stop you from going to heaven. How many know that God does not count our sin against us anymore? There's all kinds of stuff you do that's not good for you. All kinds of stuff that you put in your body is not good for you. We don't judge each other. But for some people, stuff just fall off us, and other people, stuff doesn't fall off, and we resist. There's strongholds in our life that we hold on to that we think are important, and it was always fine before. Why I got to change now? Why do I have to change now? But the Spirit of God comes in you, and He starts to work on you, and suddenly you desired something new. Suddenly you desire what He has for you. See, He's unlocked something in your future. He's got an opportunity that suddenly is coming around the corner, and it just came undone. The Word of God came out, and something about to change in your future, and God says, that thing that I've allowed you to have is going to sabotage what I'm trying to bring you, so I got to go to war with that thing, and we're going to break it off of you this morning. Somebody say amen. It always worked before. Why do I have to change now? We resist change. And so I want to show you this scripture. We're going to bang out a couple of scriptures here real quick. Isaiah 27 and 8. In measure, by sending it away, you contended with it, but He removes it. See, there's stuff that you contend with, but God just remove it. You're fighting with it, but God will remove it. In His timing, boom, He just takes it. But it says this, He removes it by His rough wind. Now say wind. Wind. That's that word spirit, ruach. He removes it by the Spirit of God. Just telling you what to do didn't work, so He just brings it in and by His Spirit. He's going to lead you. He's going to grow you. He's going to prepare you. He's going to arm you. He's going to equip you. He's going to strengthen you. He's going to raise you. And so He goes, woof, and He comes inside of you because He's like, well, we got to change something here. And so it says it's a rough wind. It is too, man. You were comfortable. Now you uncomfortable. It says, in the day of the east wind, you know, it was an east wind that blew upon the Israelites as God parted the Red Sea. He was creating a great miracle right in front of them, but it came in the form of a very harsh east wind. And they had to anchor down. And Moses was the one that said, stand still, hold your peace, and you shall see the salvation of your Lord. Why? God's doing something right now. He's at work. In Psalms 48 and verse 7 says this, as when you break the ships of Tarshish with an east wind. This word Tarshish means subjection. Noah got on the ship to Tarshish when he was supposed to go to Nineveh. How does he break this down? With an east wind. That word wind, again, ruach, spirit. He's removing something that you've been contending with and fighting about. A great east wind, a storm coming. You know, sometimes people will say God is steering you through bringing a storm into your life, but they misunderstand storm. The storm I'm going to talk about is the one that happens in here by His Spirit. He comes inside of you, and all of a sudden you're having a contention on the inside of you. You still desire the wrong things. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? No, not over here, but maybe you guys do. Sometimes you still desire. That's easy to figure out, right? But pastor said that you just, whatever you desire is what God told you to desire. No, that's not what pastor said. There's stuff that you desire that's wrong. That's easy. That's an easy one to figure out. You know for a fact that God didn't give you that desire. But then there's stuff that He brings. Now you got some new desires in you. And suddenly you want, you're like, ooh, that's new. But sometimes that new desire fight with the old desire. And so then the war begins. The Bible says in Romans chapter 8 that the flesh is at war with the Spirit. They're not happy with each other. But sometimes people think that storm is like, oh, I got my God wrecked my car because He's trying to tell me something. No, God didn't wreck your car. There was a guy, I was at Home Depot the other day, just 2 days ago. This guy's backing his truck out of Home Depot, out of the parking lot, and he's coming way too fast. I grabbed Kelly. He's like, he's coming, man. Too fast backing out. And I'm looking at it, and I'm like, hey. And he bashes, he slams his truck right into the place where you put all your carts and stuff. Boom, the whole thing comes up, made this massive noise. He comes to a stop. And so I was yelling while he was backing up. I'm like, stop, hey. Like, you don't know what to say because you're paying, hey. And I'm watching him, and he's answering his phone while he's backing up. See that? And it was doing that thing where you could, I could tell, I was really close to him. He was doing that thing. You ever do that where you're swiping and it just won't swipe? He was like backing up, and he was like, oh, it won't answer. Boom! And God didn't cause that car wreck. Look, if you don't want to get in a car wreck, don't try and answer your phone while you're driving. In life, if you don't want to wreck your life, pay attention. Somebody say amen. Sometimes we wreck our own lives. Sometimes Satan gets in there. There's a world that's messed up. But God didn't bring you that car accident. God didn't make your girlfriend break up with you. Oh, God made my girlfriend break up with me. Why would he do that? He gave me a great girl, and then he made her break up. He didn't do that. She just don't like you no more. He didn't make her not like. He just do his thing. You know, sometimes we say, well, God brought this disease into my house because he's trying to teach me. No, he's not. God's voice is this. He said, no disease will come near your home. That's God's voice. Don't forget which voice is God's voice. Somebody say amen. And so that's not the kind of storm I'm talking about. I'm talking about the thing that happens on the inside of you. When there's a tempest happening on the inside of you. When I was young, I was set to marry the wrong girl. Now, we weren't engaged, but we had, you know, you just figure out your plan. I've been dating her for 2.5 years. We went to proms together, went to homecoming together. It's a high school sweetheart. I loved her. I'd been with her 2.5 years. She's a great girl. She was a Christian girl, went to our church, got born again in our church. And but my parents, they had something different in mind. They kept bringing this family over for like Easters and stuff, like different holiday events. They'd bring this family over, and there was a teenage girl there. They'd be like, hey, how about her? You know, that's Kelly. That's Kelly. They'd bring her over. Check out Kelly. I'm like, nah, I don't, stop it. Stop. And I was mean. I was a tough kid. I was you know, public school. I was rough. I hung around the wrong kids. I could cuss a lot. I was vulgar. I'd tell dirty jokes. I got a lot of dirty. I could tell one right now, probably. I don't. So, would be the old guy. I have to dig him up and be like, man, what's some? Tell me some of them old dirty jokes you got. I was a rough kid, okay? And I hung around and I was in the wrong. And we were. And she was Miss Goody Two Shoes. You know what I'm saying? I want nothing to do with her. And but then one day, the girl I'd been dating went out of town, and I was in college now. And the girl I was dating went out of town. She was very successful in her work that she did, and they flew her out of town for some training or something. And my mom's like, well, what are you doing on Friday night? You got no date. I said, I haven't got no date. She said, why don't you come to this youth event? So I went to the youth event. My mom was the youth pastor, so we went to the youth event, and she was like, be one of my leaders, be one of my helpers. So we went to a pool party. She went to a pool party, and I'm swimming, and out comes Kelly, all right? And I'd seen her a million times, and she's a pretty girl. But you know, there's lots of pretty girls. And God made girls pretty, right? Somebody say amen. See, it's girls. Sometimes the Satan trying to convince you you're not pretty. Look, if you're a girl, you're pretty. Deal with it. God made you beautiful. He formed you. You're amazing. Okay. So there's lots of pretty girls. I'd seen lots of pretty girls. I was a single guy, you know, so I checked out pretty girls. Whatever. And so she's a pretty girl, but I'd seen that before. But all of a sudden, something different about this girl, because the Spirit of God went. Oh, wow. Okay. Wow. So I was in the pool, but man, I broke a sweat. I was like, oh, Lord Jesus. What is this I'm feeling? All of a sudden, God began to see. It didn't matter I was dating this other girl for the time that I did, but now it was about to matter. It was about to matter. And God had figured out, he was like, okay, so, you know, these two are made for each other. Kelly and Jason, they're made for each other. And she's got stuff that he needs, and he's got stuff that she needs, and together we're going places, but he's with the wrong one, so we need to figure something out. So Spirit of God, see, God could have said, hey, I want you to date her. I'd probably be like, oh, I was probably just ate too much pizza. I don't know what that voice was. But God, instead, he blows you up in your desire, and you go, oh. And suddenly I'm like, but I love this girl, but that's the girl I want to be with. I want to marry her. I could see myself married to her. I'm like, oh, Lord, am I going to marry her? That's how I'm feeling right now, but I have this other girlfriend. I was a mess. I can't be with her. She's Miss Goody Two Shoes. We don't even fit together. It will never work. Will never work, Lord. It won't ever work. I don't know why I'm having these feelings. But I didn't sleep Friday night. I didn't sleep Saturday night. I didn't sleep Sunday. I didn't sleep for 3 days. Up all night, just in my mind, trying to figure out. I boarded the ship to Tarshish. See, God visited Jonah. God visited Jonah and said, I want you to go to Nineveh and preach. And Jonah said, no, I don't want to. See, the word of the Lord come to you, but it's the Spirit of God that'll with desire, partnered with that word to get you to do what God wants you to do. We'll disobey his commands. So what he does is his spirit now is in us. So Jonah goes, no, I'm not going to go. Jonah's like, he boards the ship of, I don't want to change. And we do that. We board the ship of, I don't want to change. Right? He stepped into some ship. You know what I'm saying? That was going the wrong way. How's he going to get out of this ship? We step into ship all the time. Man, we don't need that ship. It's about to get windy, too. Ship's about to hit the fan. I can't believe I did that. Erase that. Cut that. That's not even me. I'm not even that guy. I apologize for that right now. That was out of bounds. But remember, that's who I used to be. It came out. I don't know. And so he's on the wrong boat, isn't he? And we do that. We get on the ship of, I don't want to change. And so it says in Jonah chapter 1 and verse 4, but the Lord sent out a great wind. See, this is what this whole story is about, the Spirit of God working in a life. That's the metaphor that God's painting here. Jonah means dove. That's what his name means. This is about the Spirit of God. Wind, ruach. The Lord sent out a great, it means his spirit. But he's talking about wind. On the sea. And there was a mighty tempest on the sea, so that the ship was about to be broken up. And so we have this battle inside of us. Right? Well, I've always been this way. I don't want to change. I got this new, but that's not me, God. I don't know that I can be that person. I don't think that way. I don't know if I want that. And a war starts happening on the inside of us. My backyard, it's just been dirt and weeds all this time. And I decided I want to put some grass in. I want to make it pretty. And so I got out a shovel. And how many know that the ground was resisting change? It didn't want to change. Ting! Man, it was some mean ground too. Ding! It wouldn't change. It wouldn't change. It was just like, no, hey, I've always been this way. I've been in your backyard for 2 years. Why you suddenly want to change me? You were fine with me a year ago. Why you want to make me? I was in an orchard for years before this house was even here. Man, why are you trying to change me? This is what we do to God. I say, I'm trying to make you green, man. I'm going to try and make you prettier. I'm trying to make you better. And so I went and got a jackhammer. A jackhammer. I'm not kidding you. I went there and they're like, well, you could just dig dirt with this. I said, what's that big one? Give me the big one, man. I went and rented a jackhammer from Home Depot, right? That's what God's doing. He'll go get the, man, he's not giving up on you. You think you're going to go, no, I don't want to do that. And he's going to go, okay. I say, Lord, listen, I can't be with this new girl because my friends, I've had these friends my whole high school. If Miss Goody Two Shoes ever meet my friends, she's going to find out what a fraud I am. They can never even meet. I can't even have these two worlds collide. It would be like nuclear, okay? And so what does God say? He says, oh, okay, then you don't have to go with the new girl. No, he says, get some new friends, man, because this is where we're going. Deal with it. He goes and gets his jackhammer. You know when the jackhammer came out, like all this rocks and stuff came out? My yard got messier before it got better. My wife went out and looked. She, what did you do to our yard? I'm like, we're digging trenches. Matt's out there shoveling, man. We're moving. It was a mess, right? It would look terrible. It's going to get better, but it actually got worse before it got better. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? It gets all messy. All this stuff starts coming up. And so this great east wind comes upon him. It's a great tempest. Back to the scripture. And it says that there was a tempest on the sea that's happening here so that the ship was about to be broken up. You know, God's not trying to break you. He's trying to break something off of you. You can't take that with you where he's going. You don't get to take that. He's taking you. So that opportunity that he unlocked in your future, you're going to get to it and you're going to think it's a problem and you're going to move away from it if you try and take that thing that's sabotaging you with you. So he says, I got to break that off of you. He's not breaking you. He didn't declare war on you. He declared a war on who you used to be. He's trying to unlock who he created you to be. But he's not trying to break you. It says in Leviticus chapter 26, It says this, but I am the Lord your God. I love how he says this, the way he phrases this. But I am the Lord, I am the Lord your God. He introduces himself. Hey, can I meet you for a second? See, the sometimes people treat God like he's the bad guy, and he's got to reintroduce himself. He's like, no, I'm not the bad guy. But we're at war right now. God, why are you doing this to me? He's like, I'm not the bad guy. Let me introduce myself to you. Oh, by the way, I'm the Lord your God. I'm the one who got you out of Egypt. I'm the good guy in your life, okay? I got you out of slavery, and I'm not trying to break you, but I did break the bars of your yoke. I broke that thing off of you. You know, when you carry around, it says I caused you to walk upright. When you carry around a yoke, you're like, that's what they put a yoke on an ox and they make them farm, you know, and drag stuff, and it's big, heavy weight. You get this big, heavy weight on you. It's a burden, but you think it's you. Oh, I've just always been like this. This is who I am. It's going to stay this way. And God go like this. And how does he break a yoke, man? It's on you. Bam! He breaks it with a hammer or something. I don't know what he breaks it with. Jackhammer. I don't know what he does. Man, you feel it. Why? Because it's on you. Ow! Okay, I broke it. Now let it go. No, I would keep my broken yoke all up on me. I want to keep it for a little while longer. And that's what they did. The entire crew began to take their supplies and throw them overboard. Take necessities and throw it overboard. Why? Because your crew is trying to make sure you don't change. Your crew is the voices that are on the ship with you. And they're telling you, you don't need to change, man. Just stay who you are. Be authentic, man. You got to be you. Just be authentic. God's trying to grow you into something better. And the voices are like, no, we're just going to throw some stuff overboard. We're going to be fine. You stay on the ship, man. Don't go anywhere. They start to rebalance you. There's a balancing act. See, he's all topsy-turvy. He's in the boat. He's sloshing around. There's no balance. A doctor will tell you, a spine doctor will tell you that if one part of your back is out of balance, like something gets out, then the body will adjust over the years to stay in balance. It'll make some other adjustment so that you can keep going, right? So then God will put that alignment back in to get you back. I look like Elvis now, don't I? I didn't mean to do that. That was awkward. So he gets you back. So there's a rebalancing that has to happen. When we get out of balance and then he balances us, everything else has to come. It doesn't affect just one thing. There's a lot of things that start moving. There's all these moving pieces. But it says that Jonah was sleeping in the bow of the boat during this great big storm. What did Jonah? See, Jonah's a man of God. He knows already. He already knows what's going on. He was trying to run from God. As soon as that wind blew in, he's like, oh, I already lost. I already know God's going to win. I'm not going to fight with God. When that comes in to bring change, don't fight with it. And go take a nap. God's working on some something on the inside of you. Go to sleep. Right? Samuel keeps running to Eli. Did you call for me? Eli's like, go back to bed, man. Israelites are freaking out because the Egyptians are upon them. And they're trapped by the Red Sea and they're trapped by the mountains and the chariots are coming. Go. What did Moses say? Stand still. Hold your peace. Man, you're not going to do this. You think you're going to change you? You've not been able to change you yet. God's working on you right now. Can you go take a nap? You got to enter God's rest and let him do his thing. In fact, Jonah, when he got out of it, when they woke him up, he said this. He said, you got to throw me overboard. If you want this storm to stop, you got to throw me overboard. Put me in the fate of God's hands. Put my fate in God's hands. But think about it for a second. He wouldn't even jump. Now, that's a picture for us. No work. Even the crew had to toss him overboard. He's not going to do nothing. He falls in the water. Boom, a fish swallows him. Now, the fish is a picture of the grave. You know, how do you mean? Jesus said this. He said, the Son of Man is just like Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of a fish for 3 days and 3 nights. So also will the Son of Man be in the grave for 3 days and 3 nights. He was saying that fish is just like the grave. And so what is that? That's a picture of you. You gotta go to sleep. You gotta die to who you thought you were and trust God. It's gonna, all right, God, you're doing something. I don't know what you're doing. I had plans with this other girl, but you got this new girl in mind for me. That's the one you want me to marry. I want to marry her. I hardly even know her. We haven't even had a conversation yet. We haven't even had a date. But I'm gonna break up with the old girl that I've had for 2.5 years, that I have all this history with, that I have plans with. I'm going to let go of all my plans, and I'm just going to die. I can't overthink it anymore. You got something you're doing in the inside. I don't know what you're doing, but I'm not going to sweat it. I'm not going to make a pros and cons list. I'm just going to, you're doing something, do your thing, man. I'm going to go to sleep. I'm going to let the old me die. Crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ that liveth in me. And God swallowed me up with some big smelly fish. It smells. And then he delivers me to where he wants me. I don't even have to swim to where I'm going. He takes me, they threw him in, and the fish threw him up, right up on the shore, and he set my feet on the rock. Now I'm not out of balance. Oh, you got to give the Lord some praise over that, because you didn't even swim to where he's trying to take you. I didn't have to do nothing. All I had to do was submit my will to God's will. That's where you're going to say, I broke up with the girl. On the third night, I broke up with the girl. I said, that's a hard thing to do. Like, there was, you know, I mean, you're all messed up. I was a mess. I asked the new girl out. I said, you want to go out on Friday night? She said, yeah, let's go out on Friday night. So she's a rich girl, you know, I was a poor guy. Poor. We made fun of the rich people. When you're that poor, you just make fun of rich people. You don't even like them. They're arrogant. You make stuff up about them. I was the richest. Is that like a... we just hate rich people or something? I don't know what I was, but... you know how people just hate people because they're different? Everybody does it. And so, but we shouldn't. But at that age, I was young and immature, and I just hated the rich people. We used to make fun of rich people. I don't ever be that guy. And he goes, well, look at me. I'm all proper, whatever. I'm going to wear a suit to church. Now I am that guy, whatever. That'll never be me, you say. I'd never go out with Miss Goody Two Shoes. But here I am going on a date with Miss Goody Two Shoes. So I'm all I gotta figure out, I can't even talk. How am I even gonna talk to her? Because every other word that I say is a cuss word, so I can't even talk now. I can't say anything funny because all my jokes are dirty. I just sit there quiet. I got to a restaurant I can't afford. They had something out front called valet parking. Have you ever heard of this? Valet. It's where somebody come in and take your car. We used to call it carjacking, but now you pay them. I don't know what I'm doing. I'm a fish out of water, so out of my element. I'm so upset with God. I'm so upset with the situation, but I can't not have her. I gotta have her. I don't know what else to do. Because God, something on the inside of me started to change and made everything out of control. I was sitting there having dinner with her, and I was so nervous. I'm not Mr. Cool. I never got nervous about anything, but I was so nervous around her. And so I had this is a true story. I had my glass of water. I grabbed my glass of water. I wanted to look at the time because we had a movie. I literally poured an ice water in my lap at a nice restaurant. She laughed at me. Nobody laughs at me. And then I was like, oh my gosh, oh my gosh. And I was like, wait, where are my car keys? I said this to her. You can ask her. I said, I'm so sorry. I've locked the keys in the car. I don't know what we're going to do. She goes, you valeted. They have your keys. Oh, yeah. It was just out of my element. I felt really dumb. I felt so out of my... God, what have you done to me? I just want to go back to who I was. I was so... But what does God do? He's working on the inside of us. Jonah goes to Nineveh and he preaches this message. And the Bible says that he went up on side of the hill after he preached for 3 days. He went up on the side of the hill and he waited for God to destroy that city. He wanted to sit up there and watch it like Sodom and Gomorrah. Blow it up, God, blow it up. He said, I want to preach to these people because I was afraid that they would turn their hearts to you and you wouldn't kill them. Right? And then God didn't blow him up. He said, and so Jonah says, I knew you'd do this. I knew that you were a gracious and merciful God and that you were slow to anger and you'd forgive all these people. He's like, he was mad. Why'd you forgive him? Blow him up, man. What was he saying? He was saying, I think different than you, God. And this is how God does it now. He changes what we do. And then he works on how we think. This is part two. Then he starts to work on how we think. I'll give you an example. A five-year-old at California Adventure Disneyland, I was trying to explain to my five-year-old why he wants to ride the Tower of Terror. You're five. Hey, do you want to ride this ride? What's it called, Daddy? It's called the Tower of Terror. No. Yes, you do. It's really fun. Well, it doesn't sound fun. It's okay. Get on the Tower of Terror with me. So what do? What any good parent would do? Grab him, make him ride the ride, kicking and screaming. You're going to have fun. You're going to like it. So I drag him on the ride. And then at the end of the ride, I make him do it. And at the end of the ride, he goes, oh, that was fun. And it starts to change what he thinks. See, what we do will eventually impact what we think. This is how God works. We think he's going to change our thinking, and then we'll change our doing. But that's not how he works. He's going to change your doing, and then he's going to work on your thinking. And so this is what he does to Jonah. And it happened when the sun arose. The sun represents the word of God. The word of God comes. That God prepared a vehement, boy, he throws an adjective at this one, east wind. Wow. Wind, you know it, ruah. Here comes some more wind into Jonah's life, because we're not done with you yet, Jonah. And the sun beat on Jonah's head. Right? This is not an accident. It's in the word for a reason. It's a metaphor. It's dealing with Jonah's thinking. Your stinking thinking's got to change. We've got to change how you think, right? I'm not going to leave you like this. I'm going to work on your brain now. I'm going to work. The Spirit of God is going to deal with your thoughts now. I want you to be on board with where I'm taking. Yeah, you did it, but I need you to be on board. I want you to continue to want where we're going. My stinking thinking had to change, right? I had believed that I was one person and God was moving me in a different direction. I fell in love with this girl and she ended up being the girl that I would marry, been married to for 24 years now. And I know, and I look at my family and I know that God had her for me and I praise God. And you know, the girl I dated before, great girl, Christian girl, God had someone better for her too, right? I was wrong for her, she was wrong for me. God had her in mind for me. That was going to be critical. That's a strong woman right in there. You may not know her like I know her, I'm sure you don't, but she's tough. I tell you what, if I get done preaching and I haven't been rehearsed and ready to communicate God's word, she's on me. Lord Jesus, she'll make me better at everything I do. She is magnificent in nature. She's encouraging and cheering me on. I love this woman. I thank God for what he did in my life in those days. And I didn't know the Bible very well then when I was 19 years old. And I didn't know how to listen to the voice of God. I didn't even know what God was doing. But this is how God leads you, is he comes inside. Once you receive Jesus, he takes control. He has a coup on the government of your heart. And when he needs to change you and grow you, he blows up on the inside of you. There's a vehement east wind coming on you, and the light of God begins to scorch your thoughts. And he says, I'm preparing you for the victory I have in mind for you. I've unlocked an opportunity. And that thing you said, where you said, I'll never be the kind of person that pray out loud. I'll never be the kind of person that can talk in front of people. Or you said, I'm never going to be the kind of person that'll be like this. I don't need prosperity, Pastor. I just love meager means, and I'm happy with what I have. But you don't know that God has unlocked wealth for you because he wants to finance his kingdom. And so he blows up into your life and says, I'm bringing wealth into your life, but you're going to sabotage it if you don't let this go. Let me break the ship of Tarshish off of you this morning. Can somebody give the Lord some glory this morning? Come on. Woo! Making me spit up here. Lord Jesus. The wind is bringing a change into your life. I love knowing that God is already leading me by his Spirit. And what the pastor taught you today from the Word of God is that God is already moving on your desires, that there's no work for you. In fact, when he moves on your desires, you don't need to change. You simply need to receive the change that he's bringing you. Amen. Let me pray for you. Father God, I thank you, Lord, for this word. And I ask this revelation would continue to come into our hearts. And Lord, that we wouldn't fight you when you bring us change in our lives and when you grow us up and when you create that tempest on the inside of us, that we wouldn't fight you, but that we would enter your rest and allow you to deal with those places in our lives that need to grow, that need to be developed, that need to be equipped, that need to be strengthened, that need to be empowered, that need to be sharpened in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Father God, bless your people now. Let your favor be upon them in every way. In Jesus' name. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, I want to give you an opportunity right now to give your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the part of the service where you would say, okay, yes, Lord. You would get off your ship of Tarshish. The wind of God started blowing on you right when you came in here because He's bringing change into your life. He's chosen you and He's brought you here this morning. It's not an accident that you're here. And saying this prayer is simply opening the door to the Lord to come into your life. Repeat after me. We make it easy. Everyone's going to do it with you. Dear Father God, I ask you to forgive me of all my sins. I ask you, Jesus, come into my life, come into my heart. Be my Lord and my Savior. Father God, baptize me in your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.